Thank you for clicking this link because I have never done a video quite like this before. All my previous content is about technical topics related to hardware and software tools. And I can see that my analytics are growing with this exact type of content. So why should I even bother to change anything? Well, today I decided to share about this because I used to have a lot of unrealistic beliefs about what it takes to do good work in science and engineering. You see, learning these tools are the easiest part. For me, changing these wrong beliefs was the most difficult part, and therefore I wanted to share how I did this, and one of the ways was reading biographies of some scientists and engineers. Hence, in today's video, I just want to share three things. Number one, what does the process of science and engineering look like? Number two, what does the struggles look like? You can call it bugs, obstacles, or challenges, which are inevitable along the way that we do our work. And number three, what it looks like when we first start out in this field. And I'll be referring to about four biographies that I've read in the past few years. The first one is about Nikola Tesla, who was both a scientist and an engineer. I will be referring to his autobiography that he wrote at the age of 63. The second one is about Henry Ford, who was both an engineer and an entrepreneur. I will also be referring to his autobiography that he wrote himself. The next one is about Marie Curie, who was an experimental chemist and a physicist. I will be referring to the biography written by her daughter, Eve Curie. And the youngest of them all is Albert Einstein, who was a theoretical physicist. I will be referring to the biography by Walter Isaacson. One of my most erroneous thinking was that the process of science and engineering took a lot of bold, big steps. And if you're pretty smart and talented, you probably took a few times to do it. But after reading these biographies, I realized that science and engineering instead take small steps and lots of repetitions in the face of doubt. So here's an example from Nikola Tesla writing in the chapter The Magnifying Transmitter about his process of building this and other inventions. He wrote, "These and other inventions of mine, however, were nothing more than steps forward in certain directions." Tesla here certainly means taking many, many small steps towards a certain direction. In evolving them, I simply followed the inborn sense to improve the present device without any special thought of our far more imperative necessities. So it is also interesting to note that he puts a lot more focus on the present task rather than thinking and worrying too much about something, some problem far out into the future. Similarly, in the book Madame Curie, it must be an error in the experiment, the young woman thought, for doubt is the scientist's first response to an unexpected phenomenon. She started measurements over again, unmoved, using the same products. And this was on top of her preceding experiments on all known chemical elements. So after reading this paragraph, I thought that that's a lot of experiments that both Pierre Curie and Marie Curie did. And I guess after they covered all of them exhaustively, there was only one conclusion left on the table: a new element. This element is polonium, discovered by these two scientists in 1898. Next is the concept of struggle or challenges, which is a very, very common part of science and engineering. And I used to wrongly think that these people that I always read about had it very easy, which means they probably took a few steps or they solved the problem at hand at a very, very short amount of time. But it turns out that they did find their work challenging. And just like me, they also took a long time to overcome any obstacles. So here's another example from Nikola Tesla's experience as he wrote in The Art of Tell Automatics. Involuntarily, I then turned to other work, and I am surprised at the freshness of the mind and ease with which I overcome obstacles that had baffled me before. And then he goes on to say, after weeks or months, my passion for the temporarily abandoned invention returns, and I invariably find answers to all the vexing questions with scarcely any effort. So does this happen to you as well? Let's say you are stuck on a bug and you have been scratching your head, and then you decide to take a break, let's say, go for a tea break or a lunch break. And by the time you come back, you're like, aha, that's the solution I need to try out. Well, I couldn't really explain why this happens until I learned about this in the online course, Learning How to Learn, by neuroscientists Dr. Barbara Oakley and Dr. Terence Sonotsky, and learned about the concept of focused mode versus diffused mode of thinking. Now, in the diffused mode of thinking, you can make new neural connections traveling along new pathways that might lead us to solutions of our problems. Now, a better way to understand these two types of thinking is to look at the picture analogy of a pinball machine. Now, in the diffused mode, the rubber bumpers in the pinball machine are more spaced out so that we can look at a different, bigger perspective that might lead us to the solution. So, Nikola Tesla's experience, the one he wrote in his book, tells us that going through challenges and obstacles is a common part. And when we do come across these challenges, it is okay to do a context switch to work on some other task. It is okay to take a break or even get back to the problem or the task at hand after weeks or months. Sometimes it is okay to lose interest in it and we can come back to it later. Next, let's look at Henry Ford, and here he gives some example on how long he took to build a successful car. From the period of the first car, which I have described, until the formation of my present company, I built in all about 25 cars, of which 19 or 20 were built with the Detroit Automobile Company. So the first car that he built was in the year 1893. And then he built 25 cars until the present company, which is when he created Ford Motor Company in 1903. That's 10 years that he took building 25 car prototypes even before incorporating the Ford Motor Company that he founded. He goes on to say, the big thing is the product, and any hurry in getting into fabrication before designs are completed is just so much waste time. I spent 12 years before I had a Model T, which is what is known today as the Ford car that suited me. Finally, I want to read some snippets and stories of these scientists and engineers when they were a beginner and when they were first starting out. Whether we are getting started in creating our first prototypes, getting our first rejections, or even receiving our education, the beginning stages can look very discouraging. Let's revisit Henry Ford, and here we will look at a snippet about his first prototype of building a car that was in 1893, long before the Ford Model T or his Ford Motor Company that he founded. He wrote, "My gasoline buggy was the first and for a long time the only automobile in Detroit. It was considered to be something of a nuisance, for it made a racket and it scared the horses. Also, it blocked traffic. For if I stopped my machine anywhere in town, a crowd was around it before I could start up again." So from his first prototype, let's now jump to Ford Model T years down the road. On May 31st, 1921, the Ford Motor Company turned out car number 5 million. It is out in my museum along with the gasoline buggy that I began work on 30 years before and which first ran satisfactorily along in the spring of 1893. So let's recap the years just like a history lesson. 1893, Henry Ford built his first car prototype, which he calls the gasoline buggy. And then 10 years later in 1903, he incorporated the Ford Motor Company after building about 25 car prototypes. And then again, 5 years later in 1908, Ford Motor Company came out with the Model T. And then again in 1921, about 13 years later, the 5 million cars were produced for Ford Model T. Now, from the beginning of 1893 to 1921, that's a span of 28 long years that Henry Ford took along with his team to come to Ford Model T, a successful product line. Similarly, let's look at Albert Einstein and what it looks like when we first start out to look for opportunities in our chosen field. Einstein churned out job-seeking letters, ever more pleading to the professors around Europe. They were accompanied by his paper on the capillary effect, which proved not particularly impressive. He rarely even received the courtesy of a response. I will soon have graced every physicist from the North Sea to the southern tip of Italy with my offer. So this is the letter he wrote to his wife after his PhD in 1901, lamenting about the state of his affairs. Now, he also applied for a job application with Wilhelm Oswald, who is a fellow scientist and a Nobel laureate, and he, of course, rejected him as well. 1901, Albert Einstein applied for a research position in Oswald's laboratory. Oswald rejected Einstein's application. However, 9 years later, Oswald nominated Einstein for the Nobel Prize in 1910. You know, I used to take rejections so personally. And stories like this is a clear reminder that even if teams, people, or organization reject me today, they might give me some other offer in a delightful way sometime in the future. Well, maybe not nominating me for a Nobel Prize, but you get the idea. The final story that I would like to share is all about starting late. And I used to regret so much about not learning programming. And I learned programming very, very late at the age of 20. And here's a story of Marie Curie at the age of 21. She's writing a letter to Joseph, her brother, in October 1888. Think of it, I am learning chemistry from a book. You can imagine how little I get out of that, but what can I do as I have no place to make experiments or do any practical work? Well, here at the age of 21, Marie Curie was working as a governess to help pay for her elder sister's education. 3 years later, what happens? In 1891, age 24, she finally followed her sister to Paris, where she earned her higher degrees and conducted her scientific work. So I hope you got something out of these stories from the four scientists and engineers, Nikola Tesla, Henry Ford, Marie Curie, and Albert Einstein. No doubt they were set in the previous century at a different era, but I believe the timeless principles of doing the work in science and engineering still remain the same. It takes small steps, lots of repetitions, lots of iterations and prototypes, many, many rejections, struggles, and many, many years. But in the end, we do what we do because we love the task at hand. So I would also like to know from all of you, which biography of scientists, engineers, or even entrepreneurs inspire you? Thank you once again for watching a very different content from me. Let me know if you enjoyed this, and see you next time. Bye.